瞬間移動能力とは、思った場所に一瞬で移動できる能力のことである。自由の戦士イナズマン。
1973 was an incredible year for henshin heroes and the realization of many of Shotaro Ishinomori's characters for live-action television. The year got started off with a bang, with the premiere of Kamen Rider V3 in February, which would be followed by Robot Detective, Ultraman Taro, and Full Lion Maro in April, Kikaida 01 in May, and Tiger 7 and Inazuman in October. Initially conceived as an animated work by Cyborg 009 producer Yoshifumi Hatano, Inazuman was originally intended to counter the live-action henshin hero boom that had been kickstarted by the Kamen Rider series. Going by the working title Mutant Z, Inazuman incorporated many supernatural and occult elements as a way to take advantage of the explosive interest in these topics during this period. While this concept for an animated series didn't go beyond the concept stage, the proposal for the show caught the attention of Toei TV producer Toru Hiroyama. Hiroyama, who previously helped bring Kamen Rider and Kikaida to life as TV series, championed the concept and secured the green light to produce it as a henshin hero live-action TV series under a new name, Inazuman. Taking a page out of his proven playbook, he once more partnered with Ishinomori, who took on the task of coming up with the character designs and helping produce the manga that would run concurrently with the TV show. Additionally, he will go on to direct episode 11 of the series, a particularly noteworthy episode that helped the series transition to a darker tone that would take the story and its characters in a new direction for the second half of its run. To help bring the title character to life, Daisuke Ban, who previously played the lead role in Kikaida, was brought on board. Other previous collaborators of Hiroyama would also go on to join the project, including Kamen Rider and Kamen Rider V3 screenwriters Masaru Igami and Masayuki Shimada, plus Susumu Takahisa, whose previous tokusatsu works included Ambassador Magma, Captain Ultra, Spectre Man, and Kaiketsu Lion Maru. On the musical front, Mishiaki Watanabe was tapped to help with the series soundtrack. Before kickstarting production work for the television series, costumes for the title character were assembled and tested. The design team had delivered costumes that closely follow Ishinomori's designs for Inazuman, but suit actor Fumiya Nakamura found that they were hard to perform in. Specifically, he found that the integrated shoulder piece in the Inazuman costume made movements very difficult. This led to some last-minute changes that resulted in the suit that we saw used in the series. However, because these changes were made relatively close to when the show started filming, some merchandise and promotional photography depicting the integrated design found their way to the general public. The actor also noted some difficulties with the Sanagiman costume, which resulted in a new design that would be used starting with episode 5. Premiering on October 2nd, 1973, Inazuman's inaugural run coincided with a downturn in enthusiasm for the henshin boom programs that had dominated the airwaves in the previous 2 years. This led to less than ideal ratings for Inazuman when compared to Kamen Rider V3, which were further compounded when, on November 16, the Japanese cabinet outlined emergency measures to help the country deal with the growing oil crisis, but which also resulted in consumer price indexes jumping by as much as 23% and negative economic growth in 1974. This crisis had a big impact on all industries, including the expensive to produce tokusatsu hero programs of this period. So, between the drop in viewership and higher than anticipated production costs, Inazuman went through a lot of retooling as the show progressed through its first season. This is reflected across three distinct phases of this first season. In the first phase, which roughly runs between episodes 1 and 10, we're introduced to Watari Goro, his college friend Marumi Gosaku, and the Youth League, a group made up of young people who have Esper powers and who are on a mission to protect the world from the Neo-Human Empire. The Neo-Human Empire, which is led by Emperor Bamba, is in search of mutants, who in the world of Inazuman are Espers with special powers. Emperor Bamba believes that in 50 years, the world will be thrown into a crisis and food shortages through the overpopulation of humans. So he seeks to build an empire of mutants that will rid the world of humanity and establish a new world order. These ambitions are reflected throughout these first 10 episodes, with Emperor Bamba sending his mutant robots out for a wide range of missions that included the kidnapping, recruitment, and assassination of various individuals who they identified as mutants. However, standing in their way is the Youth League, who in episode 1 recruits Goro to their organization after they discover that he is a particularly powerful mutant. They help him unlock the ability to transform into the powerful fighter of freedom, Inazuman, and provide him with his special flying car, Raijingo. Together, they will take on the Neo-Human Empire and stop them from advancing their world domination plans. Throughout these first 10 episodes, we would see their battles unfold and get insights into both organizations' motives and personalities. However, as the series progresses towards its 10th episode, the Youth League begins to disappear into the background as part of the show's overall narrative. Episode 9 will be the last time Goro wears his uniform, and after episode 10, the Youth Leaguers are essentially removed from the storyline, and the few characters who stay on as members of the cast play more of a general support role to Goro than an actual organized group with special equipment and powers, as they are depicted in episode 1. This leads us to the second phase of Inazuman's story, which is kicked off in episode 11, in which we are introduced to Watari Shinobu, Goro's mother. Shocked to discover that she was actually alive, Goro is forced to confront a terrible reality, that she had been revived by the Neo-Human Empire as one of their mutant robots. This leads to an emotional conflict that ends with Shinobu sacrificing herself to save Goro from an attack by Emperor Bamba. This results in a readjustment of the storyline and Goro's driving motivation, which will run through episode 17. In this phase of the show, Goro is driven by the grief he experienced when he lost his mother, and it's a theme that is consistently referenced by him and members of the Neo-Human Empire. As such, the series takes on a darker tone with storylines that feature humans who have been captured by the Empire, the poisoning of Goro, and an imposter committing violent crimes while looking like Goro. Then, starting with episode 18 and running through episode 25, we see another change in the tone of the series and the third phase in the show's run. This was the result of screenwriter Shoso Uehara joining the production team. Having previously worked on Robo Detective and the Ultraman series, he helped take the storyline in a new direction that further removed previous aspects of the show. These last 8 episodes abandon the focus the story had on Goro's grief over the loss of his mother, and narrow their focus on Goro, Gosaku, and that episode's mutant robot. There's also more emphasis on the confrontations between Goro and the mutant robots, with more elaborate setups and situations that need Goro to outthink his opponents with clever moves or escapes from death traps. They also serve the function of helping the series shift away from the Neo-Human Empire and Emperor Bamba as the antagonists of the story and set up the Despair Army, who would take on Inazuman in the sequel series Inazuman Flash. It's in these last episodes in the series where we see a lot of the visual and action concepts that have been explored throughout the series really come together, featuring more visually interesting battle scenes, unique duels between Inazuman and his opponents, and more inventive uses of Raijingo to bring to life bigger scale settings. These are the episodes I tend to think of when Inazuman comes to mind. While the iteration and reworking of Inazuman's core concepts are not unique in the realm of tokusatsu hero shows, it is noteworthy given the production and creative teams behind it, plus the point in time in which the series was produced. But despite the shifts the series went through, the core elements around Inazuman were consistently fun and made for an entertaining presentation of our hero. From his first stage transformation into Tsunagimon, to the build-up towards him being able to shout "Summon Supreme Power" and transforming into his Inazuman form, the show delivers the kind of excitement that fans of the Henshin Boom era heroes have come to expect and enjoy. Going beyond the traditional fighting scenes we've come to expect from Toei, the series also featured unique powers and abilities that at times give this show a surreal-like flavor. These included scenes where Inazuman takes on the Neo-Human Empire in Raijingo, which typically shifts the action segments to scenes that are entirely driven by the use of miniature special effects. This helped the show deliver visually unique scenarios, like air-to-air combat, Inazuman flying through the sky to help redirect a high-flying missile, or having to fend off giant art supplies in the air. This was true in the way that the mutant robot powers were depicted too, with many of them having the ability to pull Inazuman into unique realms where their powers resided. This led to trippy visuals that reflected their elements or themes and in which Inazuman would find himself trapped. Beyond its original TV series run, Inazuman was also featured in a Toei 3D movie in 1974. Playing as part of Toei's manga festival in March of that year, and alongside Mazinger vs. the Dark General, Five Riders vs. King Dark, and many other popular titles from that year, this movie featured a retelling of the transition to the Despair Army as the main antagonist in the series. It would also be Toei's last 3D tokusatsu movie until 1989's Running into the Kamen Rider World, which featured Kamen Rider Black RX and Kamen Rider Black. The series will go on to be one of the few Henshin Boom era shows to make their way to the United States via Kiku TV in Hawaii in the 1970s, alongside Kikaida, Kamen Rider V3, and the first Sentai series, Himitsu Sentai Go Ranger. Inazuman was also serialized as a manga by Shotaro Ishinomori in Weekly Shonen Sunday, which ran in parallel to the TV series from 1973 until 1974. It tells a different story than the TV series and features a more organic design for Inazuman that differs in significant ways from the one depicted in the TV show. If you're interested in checking it out, this manga is available in the US through the Comixology platform. Overall, while the series struggled to find its footing in its initial run, little by little it found its way to telling ever more exciting Henshin hero stories and establishing the foundation for a classic character. It would also set up a 23 episode sequel series that will take cues from the improvements the production team made throughout this show's run, Inazuman Flash. We'll explore this follow-up series in a future video. In the meantime, if you're interested in checking out Inazuman, stop by the Toei Tokusatsu World YouTube channel using the link in the description below. Several episodes are available to stream there. Or even better, stop by the Generation Kikaida store to pick up the entire series on DVD.